Good evening, everybody. Today evening, we have very, very special guest lecture to be given by Professor Mashelkar. And the session will be chaired by Professor Kakodkar. Since Professor Kakodkar does not require any introduction, and he has already been introduced in the morning, but I will say few lines about him. Professor Kakodkar is basically a mechanical engineer and turned to an Indian nuclear scientist. He was the chairman of Atomic Energy Commission of India and the secretary to the government of India. He was director of Bhabha Atomic Research Center during 1996-2000. He was awarded a Padma Vibhushan. Apart from playing a major role in India's nuclear test, Kakodkar champions India's self-reliance on thorium as a fuel for nuclear energy. He joined the reactor engineering division of the BRC and played a very key role in design and construction of Dhruva reactor. And as you know that it is completely indigenous and the high-tech project. Further, he has led the indigenous development in India's pressurized heavy water reactor technology. So I request Professor Kakodkar to come on the dais and take the chair and introduce Professor Mashelkar.
Well, friends, I consider it my proud privilege to be sitting next to a very dear friend and colleague, Dr. Mashelkar, one of the most eminent scientists of our country. And he is here to give a special evening talk on a topic which is very relevant to the theme of our meeting, but is also very close to Dr. Mashelkar's heart. Innovation, leapfrogging to pole vaulting. And when we talk about innovation, the first name that comes to your mind is obviously Dr. Mashelkar. He has been championing this movement, I think more than a decade now, or maybe even longer, two decades. And I have heard some of his lectures, and more particularly some of the terms he uses. And one is in the context of taking India forward. I hope he will not mind, but he describes himself as a dangerous optimist. And his enthusiasm about driving science for national development, one can also describe as a very infectious enthusiasm. The theme of this meeting, today's and tomorrow's meeting, basic research, its role in national development, I can easily reword as science-based innovation in the country. I think it will mean almost the same thing or the same connotation. And so, obviously, after listening a series of presentations during the day, I think it's a grand finale for the day. The meeting is going to continue tomorrow. To hear Dr. Mashelkar on this very important theme is, I think, a great treat for all of us. I don't have to introduce Dr. Mashelkar. I think if we don't know Dr. Mashelkar, then we should question ourselves about our credibility to be a member of scientific community. And so I'm going to leave it at that and request Dr. Mashelkar to make his presentation.
Thank you very much, Anil, for those wonderful remarks. What else would you expect from an affectionate brother? I feel privileged to have known Anil for a number of years, and I have the blessings of my sister, affectionate sister, Manjuji, sitting right in front. So I feel very, very privileged with both of you and my entire family of NASI, the scientists, the young students, the future of India in front of me. Before I begin my talk, let me clarify a couple of things. I was missing from morning's function, which I should not be. But what happens, there is still no technology by which the same person can be at two places at the same time. I had to chair the IIT Bombay Monash Research Academy meeting, which was set up almost 4 or 5 months ago. And I couldn't change it because there were people from Australia and everywhere joining. Anil, of course, will know about it because you're the chairman of IIT Bombay. You know the way these things go. So I'm sorry about that. And again, I wish there was a technology by which the same person could be at two places. As I speak, Pune International Center, of which I am the president, I was supposed to preside over a function by Reserve Bank of India governor on a major meeting that we have on future of jobs and jobs in our future, which is getting inaugurated as I'm speaking from here. And Dr. Vijay Kelkar, who is again like a very affectionate brother, who is the vice president, he is now deputy for me. So we managed to meet these contradictions somehow or the other. So my apologies for not being there in the morning. And I have to make another concession. The title of my talk might be somewhat intriguing for you, but it will unfold as we sort of move along. Innovation from leapfrogging to pole vaulting. I must say that I should have added a subtitle that this is a view from a personal lens, what I have seen. I came back to Pune 15 November 1976, and this is now the 41st year. All that I have done is to not only do science, but lead science in my own small way with only one organization, CSIR. And during that time, I've been able to see a lot. So you will see what I have seen. So these views may be somewhat prejudiced. You'll have to bear with me. But these are views from my own lens. They are not from any textbook. They are from the book of my own life, the way I have actually viewed it. I thought I will give these two clarifications because occasionally, if a photograph of mine flashes, it is simply because I was there when things were happening. So I think it is important that I clarify that. Now, the basic issue about innovation, and you are absolutely right, Mr. President, when you mentioned about science and development. You talk about science, you talk about research, and what does research do? It converts money into knowledge. Government gives us grants, money comes in, and we use it to create new knowledge. And what does innovation do? Innovation converts knowledge into money and social good. Social good is development, of course. All right? So therefore, the equation fits in absolutely perfectly. Science and development gets linked to research and innovation. And what we are talking about is innovation. Innovation and invention have to be differentiated. Invention remains in a laboratory, but innovation is a successful journey from mind to marketplace. All right? That is a tough journey, by the way, because it just doesn't depend upon the quality of your invention. It depends upon the ecosystem in which you actually flower. Idea is like a seed, for example, all right? It has to be put in the right soil, the inputs must go in. As the plant grows, you must take care of it. And the fruits of innovation you get only when the tree is full grown. And that's a big journey. That's a tough journey, as we have discovered in nuclear research, or we have discovered in civilian research, and so on and so forth. But then I'm qualifying. I'm saying, enough of crawling, enough of incrementalism. Can we take a big jump? And I'm saying, leapfrogging to pole vaulting. Why? There's a scientific research paper in Science, in Nature, which shows that the frog leaps because he's scared of predators in response to that. So he leaps to survive, not to succeed. Pole vaulting, you take the size of the pole that you want, basically. Put all your energy into it. The size of your aspiration is the size of the pole, and you can cross continents, basically. I think that's the new India one we'd like to see. All right? And what that means is something that I will unfold as we move along. In fact, you are absolutely right. I've been propagating innovation for a number of years now. In 1998, I got the J.R.D. Tata Corporate Award, Leadership Award, basically. You know, it's supposed to be for corporate leaders, but I think somehow or other I got it. And I remember in my speech I had said this. So when you said how much time, I said 2 decades. It is exactly 2 decades, 1998, this speech. And I will read out to you what I had said there. I had said, finally, 1999 should be the year where we should launch a powerful national innovation movement to propel us into the next millennium. The I in India should not stand for imitation and inhibition. It must stand for innovation. The I in IIT, the I in ICER maybe, must stand for innovation. The I in industry, the I in CSR must stand for innovation. The I in every individual Indian must stand for innovation. This is 20 years ago. I'm reproducing it, all right? This is covered in my book, Reinventing India. So I've been passionate about innovation for very, very long indeed. Now, you will say, fine, great. Innovation is going to be the key for our competitiveness. Innovation is going to be the key for large number of other things, including inclusion, basically. So how are we doing vis-a-vis the rest of the world? So I'll show you how we're doing through the Global Innovation Index that actually ranks different nations around 141. And in this index, I must warn you, all my lectures will be first bad news and then the good news. So here is also bad news and the good news. Our rank was 62 in 2011. What do you expect the following year? 64. Following, 66. Following, 76. Following, 81. What's happening? We kept on sliding. Why? Not because we're not doing well. We're pumping in money. You saw lots of good things that are happening. But you know, where you are depends upon where your competitors are. You might be running, but if your competitors are running faster than you, you lag behind. So that's what is happening. The rest of the nations are running, sprinting. So that is the bad news, 62 to 81. But I promise you, I'll give you the good news. From 81, we have jumped to 66, and now to 60. All right? So jump of 20 in last 2 years. We must continue to jump. We must continue to jump. All right? And it's not just in ease of doing business. It is in innovation, in science, in technology, that we must achieve such jumps. The changing face of science and technology in India, if you just see, as you sort of reflect, and I loved Balram Bhagavad's sort of historical perspective, mine is here. I think if you look at 1930s to 50s, it was individual excellence. The time of J.C. Bose and Raman and Ramanujan and whole range of individuals who actually excelled. If you look at 50 to 70, it was self-reliance. Okay? Somehow or other, import substitution became extraordinarily important because we didn't have dollars, we did not have access to technology, and so on. 1970 to 90, I would say, technology, denial-driven science and technology. And one of our great heroes who did a lot and is still leading is Anil himself, denial-driven innovation. for love or for money, the technology was not available. Whether it was space, whether it was defense, whether it was atomic energy and the rest of it, and we would continue to say thank you very much and sort of we will move forward. I mean, the classical example right on this campus, this is a historical campus, is CDAC, Center for Development of Advanced Computation. When we got Param, we were forced to go for parallel processing based architecture to create our own Param because it was denied. We wanted it for weather forecasting, but conditions were such that US would not want to sort of give it. And not that those conditions are over, they continue in a very subtle and not so subtle way. If you look at the next period, I would say 1990 to 2010, that is where we started talking in terms of intellectual property generation, global competition and so on and so forth. And I'm hoping that as we move forward, we will have the global science technology leadership. Do you see the shape of the curve? Exponential. I don't like curves which flatten out, by the way. Okay? There are two ways of going up. Right? Vijayalakshmi? One is this way, the other one is exponential. Alright? I want to see exponential innovation, exponential technology, exponentially growing India, by the way. And how is it possible? We'll just see. If you the paradigm shift that I'm going to talk about, by the way, I will live with five mantras, basically. I like to do five things, like Science Congress, you know, on this very campus when I spoke, I remember year 2000, new Panchasheel for the new millennium, child-centered education, woman-centered family, human-centered development, knowledge-centered society, innovation-centered India. It's good to talk in terms of five things, somehow or other I like it. So I would like to see paradigm shift in five mantras. The first is leap frog to pole vault, and I explained to you what I mean by that, okay? Because frog can leap only a few feet. If you ride on a pole, it can take you miles, actually. The second is jugaad to systematic innovation. Jugaad is making it happen somehow, cost being the only consideration, no consideration for safety, all right? No, that's not the way. Systematic innovation. Third, best practice to next practice. We are all very fond of current best practice. I am following the current best practice. So what? You are following the current best practice. You are copying the current best practice. Can we not create our own practice, next practice? Next, incremental to disruptive. Incremental is making a 20% change. Disruptive is making 20 times change. All right? 2000% change, basically. Can we do that? In terms of performance, in terms of speed, and so on. And the last one is, we are very fond of first to India. We have to become first to the world. As somebody has said, in science, only those people are remembered, by the way, who say either the first word in science or the last word in science. Of course, there is nothing like a last word in science. All right, we have not done it often enough. Okay, how can we do that? These are the five mantras. Now you say all of these are impossible, and I will show you all of these are possible. That's why I'm dangerously optimistic, by taking real examples of real life that I have seen from my own personal life. Let me come to the leapfrogging. I chair this Reliance Innovation Council. It's a very interesting one for the last 10 years, by the way. We have John Marilyn, the Nobel laureate, as a member. We have Bob Grubbs, Nobel laureate as a member. George Whitesides, who is the highest cited scientist in the world, by the way, with H index of 186. But the market cap of his companies is close to $30 billion. You know, we always have this challenge on Saraswati and Lakshmi. Either we do Saraswati Puja or Lakshmi Puja. Here is a fellow, you know, who has excelled in reaching the highest heights as far as Saraswati Puja is concerned, as well as Lakshmi Puja. Then we have Bill Hasseltine, many of you might sort of know him, human genome science and so on. And Gary Hamel. C.K. Prahlad used to be a member, by the way, great thought leader, but as you know, he passed away. And his place has been taken by him. And interestingly, Mukesh Ambani, who is the chairman of Reliance, is a member of this particular council. And I have learned a lot from this because each one of them is a great thought leader, by the way. Okay? And we continue to sort of challenge ourselves, not look at the best practice, but the next practice and so on and so forth, etc. The experiential part that we talked about and so on. So in order to service that, we have created what is called as a Reliance Innovation Leadership Center in Pune. And if you read carefully, you will see here at the inauguration, this photograph was around 10 years ago. Growth is life, is what Reliance always says. Innovation as a way of life, and therefore innovation-led growth is what we keep on discussing. And we are very fortunate to have Professor Mishra on the board. He's even senior to me on the board, and he has seen the way we move. So one of our discussion with Mukesh in the council meeting was on not just growth, not linear growth, exponential growth. How do we achieve exponential growth? Okay. And I remember he saying, Doc, we must leapfrog. And then we went into this definition of leapfrogging and what does it mean and how many feet we can go. And we said, yeah, leapfrog, fine, you can go a few feet. You must pole vault. Okay. And that idea was taken in order to create what you call as a leadership program. This program is called Beyonders. What does it do? It is a program which harnesses young leaders with an ambition to pole vault beyond the realms of possibilities. I emphasize the word beyond the realms of possibilities. Okay. Now, for example, if you see, you have all heard about Jio that was launched. Okay. Now, in Jio, if you see, in terms of the mobile data transmission, in terms of millions of GB per month, if you see the numbers, India was at 20, US was 710, China 630, Japan 470, and South Korea 180. So if we are leapfrogging, we would have moved from 20 to 40, 40 to 60, 60 to 100, 100 to 200. You know what we have done in the last 6 months? Added 1,000. We are number one. 2 years ago, we are 155th in the world. Had we leapfrogged, we would have gone from 155th to 100 to 50 and so on. From there, we have leaped to number one. Now you would say, how? And what is the connection with innovation here? Oh, maybe he must have earned a lot of money. No. There's a huge innovation. How do you create so many customers? For example, if you see, so India pole vaults to number one in public domain. Number of years to reach 50 million users. Anil, this is a very interesting data. For telephone, it took 50 years. For mobile, 12 years. For YouTube, 4 years. For Facebook, 3 years. For Twitter, 2 years. And you know how much time Reliance Jio took? 83 days. Because so far, we always used to admire the charts, right? Hey, Facebook is doing this, Google is doing this, Apple is doing this, etc. I'm very happy to say now we are sitting at the table, all right, and making a difference. And there was an innovation on onboarding, by the way, which of course was held by the fact that we have smartphones, we have Aadhaar card, which is identity, as well as authentication, and so on and so forth. So the entire process was onboarding in 5 minutes rather than 5 days, basically. But that helped. That is part of the innovation, by the way. It's not just technology. It is workflow innovation, system delivery innovation, and so on and so forth. Now, the key drivers in all this, always, the first most important is talent. And I'm very proud of Indian talent, by the way. I'm very, very proud. In fact, I remember our erstwhile Prime Minister, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, used to say, India's future is in IT, IT as in information technology. I also used to say, India's future is in IT, but not as in information technology, as in Indian talent, the one that you see here, basically. Okay? So that we have. Coupled with that, of course, is technology. But most important, along with that, is trust. We have the talent, we have the technology, we must have the trust. And the combination of these three is the one which will take you far. I'll just... just to prove the point, I'll give you an anecdote. Bill Gates had come to India about 8 or 9 years ago. And I remember Nandan Nilekani, myself, and Anand Mahindra, and a couple of others, Arun Mahira, and one more, we were invited for a dinner come discussion with him. This was the meeting when I met him. Of course, I don't know what I'm telling him, but he's listening seriously, as you can see. But anyway, the point was that he narrated us a very interesting story. So he said, he was recalling his old days, and he said in Harvard University, he was asked to give the commencement lecture. And he went there and he declared that he was the most successful dropout from Harvard University. Of course, which he was. And then he told us something interesting. He said there was a company in Albuquerque which was going to manufacture hardware, computer hardware. Those were early days. So he said, if they are going to manufacture hardware, they will require software. So he phoned them up and offered software. Half thinking, he tells us, that they will keep the phone down. Because 19, 20 year old kid, you know, in those early days, offering software, what is it? They did not keep the phone down. They said, we are not yet ready. Come after a month. And then Bill Gates tells us, he said, thank God they said come after 30 days. Because I did not have the software I was offering. Where does the trust come? The trust in himself that he will be able to deliver it. And the trust by the society that young man will be able to deliver it. If you ask me what is our greatest challenge today, it's not budget deficit. It is trust deficit, basically. So in order to leapfrog, in order to pole vault, in order to take large enough pole, all right, not the size of this table, but the size of this roof, basically, we require that trust that my kid will do it. All right? We can't talk about Startup India unless the parents say, come on, don't be a sort of a job seeker, don't apply, be a job provider, so as to say. So I think this is very, very fundamental indeed. And you would see that is that happening. That is happening. Just see here, the Startup India, the valuations, the way they are growing. You can see from here to here how the valuations are changing from 100 million to 500 million to billion to 5 billion and so on. But I don't like the shape of the curve. Vijayalakshmi, you can see that. It's flattening out, right? I like to see exponential. That exponential I see in the attitude of the young, by the way. That is very important. I interact a lot with young people. So, a few months ago, I was interacting with young people and the title of my talk was Satyam Shivam Sundaram. I said, Satya Nadella is the CEO of Microsoft. Sundar Pichai, the CEO of Google. So I say, Satyam Shivam Sundaram, there is a vacancy, Shiva, for Apple maybe. So one young fellow got up. And Anil, it's very interesting. These young people are very respectful to you. Huh? They will call you sir. But they told me, sir, you don't understand anything. So I said, why? What happened? They said, look, in your generation, your only ambition was to go to US somehow. Somehow, that is it. The next generation, the only ambition was to get a job, good job, in Microsoft, in Google. The next generation, no, we must become CEOs of these. He said, not my generation, our generation. Our generation wants to create our own Googles, our own Microsoft here in India. That is the explanation. And therefore, there is a responsibility on us. When we talk about such Indian talent, filled with such enthusiasm about their future, I think it is our moral responsibility sort of to help them by doing large number of things. I will come to that later. Let me come to the first part I've covered, leapfrog to pole vault, by giving you just one example. I can give more. The other one is jugaad to systematic innovation. Now, if you see jugaad, we see, because constraints of resources, makes you do jugaad. You don't have resource, what do? So, for example, you have a challenge, let us say, that there are 5 people who are wanting tea. Okay? And you don't have 5 people to serve them. But you have to fill 5 cups at the same time. Just think about it. People will find it very difficult to get a solution, but not in India. You can see. Isn't that interesting? Alright? So, on one hand, we are doing jugaad, but on the other hand, in terms of systematic innovation, look at what we have been able to do. ISRO launches 104 satellites in a single mission, world record. So, this is the duality of India for you. A chaiwala filling 5 cups instantly with an innovation which nobody else has done, and India launching 104 satellites, making us so proud. Alright? That is actually India's duality. That's what makes it interesting. And you can see the example that I've given from jugaad to systematic innovation. You know, we used to take great pride in saying that we give a missed call. Are, what is missed call? Missed call is jugaad. You are not paying for it. But somebody else is paying for it. A telecom company is paying for it. From there, through systematic innovation, thanks to Jio, we have moved to free voice call. Okay? And from there, through systematic innovation, we have moved to video call. An extremely affordable video call. Can you imagine there is an old mother here in Pune and she wants to talk to her son on the border. She not only can talk to him, she can see him on the video. For what? 10 rupees per GB is the data. Alright? Couple of minutes call, 3-4 minutes call that she is talking will take her 1 or 2 rupees. Alright? And she can talk and see her son every day. So can you imagine, from a jugaad of a missed call, we have come to a situation where you are able to perform, I mean do and experience this. That is my India. Alright, I don't take pride in saying that India is a jugaad nation. We have to be a leader in terms of real innovation. Let me take the third point, the best practice to next practice, the current best practice to next practice. I have created in my mother's name Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award. And that award came because of a very sentimental reason. It's a very interesting story, by the way. 11.5 years I was Director General of CSIR, and every Saturday, Sunday I'll be in my lab, by the way. My research continued even when I was there. And Sunday evening I'll go back. And whatever cash I will have in my pocket like this, I'll give it to her. I never asked her what she did with it. After she passed away, when Shruti, my daughter, was actually clearing her saris, she saw among that saris all that stacked up with a little note to me. You're a scientist, do something for the poor. So, Anil, that amount that I received at your hand in Goa, you remember that prize? Yes. I put all that money plus some of mine, etc., and created this Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award. It's a small award, just 1 lakh per year. This is the 7th year. Mark the words, it is Inclusive Innovation Award. Including the excluded, the poorest of the poor, giving them the benefit, I think is very important. Now, all the award is, by the way, and here, we don't give the award to the best practice. We give it to the next practice. And if you see here, the award is, the first is, Mishkin Ingawale, who created a rupees 10 for a hemoglobin detection test, 5 rupees for an ECG test, Rahul Rastogi, and then we have this young Mihir Shah creating $1 for breast cancer screening. And in each of this case, it is not the current best practice, but the next practice. Let me explain. For example, the best practice to next practice, you go for ECG, you will lie down, there will be 12 leads and the rest of it, you know the way it goes, right? That's the current best practice. The next practice is, I have a smartphone-like device which I can basically use, all right? I wish I had carried it. I forgot to carry it. I could have shown it to you. So you put your two fingers for 15 seconds, your sensor, basically you put it around your heart, all right, at prescribed positions, and within 3 minutes, if you have downloaded an app called Sanket, you will get the ECG. What it means is that even in a remote village, if there is a lady, it's so simple to perform, basically, the ECG will be in the hand of an expert within just 3 minutes. You can imagine that. So how does it actually work? So this is a personal 12-lead ECG event monitor, portable, credit card size. This is Rahul Rastogi. And Vijayalakshmi, you just mentioned about Tata's giving you 75 crore. It's a very interesting case. 17 November we give the award because that's the day my mother left us. When he came to us, it was 6-lead, not 12-lead. And you know, I have this penchant there. It has to be the best. So I said, 12-lead, what will it take? So he gave me a calculation showing 46 lakhs. Tata Trust had invited me to talk about, you know, future and the rest of it. So I had carried this with me and I showed it to them. And I said, here is what can be transformational, but it has to become 12-lead. It requires 46 lakhs. You know that check was written in how many days? Not days, 48 hours. Tata's. All right? Their heart is in the right place. In fact, I would not be standing here but for Tata's. That 60 rupees per month scholarship for 6 years. You know, I was about to leave my education and that's why we are standing. So your great research, what Rahul has been able to do, Mashelkar, you know, I think the T in Tata stands for that trust, basically. That's really wonderful. So the way it works is download the free mobile app, touch Sanket with thumbs, get ECG and interpretation on the mobile by email, for example, you can basically send it. Young Mishkin Ingawale, his challenge was interesting. He would go to villages and find women were dying of anemia. Why? Because the subcritical hemoglobin levels were not detected in time. Why? Because they refused to give blood, because they thought it was precious. So he said, thank you, I will not take blood, I will do it non-invasively. Wrap around the finger and do it. And he did Google search and found nobody had done it, basically. That's the beauty about young innovators, by the way. There's a nice definition of young innovator. Innovator is one who does not know it cannot be done. The problem with gray hair is that we know that it cannot be done. Not these young guys. So he said he went for it. And from best practice to next practice. What was that? Best practice was invasive with needles. Next practice, non-invasive with no needles. Cost per test, 150, 10. That's it. That's what he worked on. And the interesting part was the high technology he used. Photoplethysmography, spectrophotometry, advanced software for photon scattering. Okay? So this is a great instance of making high technology work for the poor through what he calls as a touch HP. Making high technology work for the rich, my friends, is very easy. Making low technology work for the poor, very easy. Making high technology work for the poor is the challenge. The interesting part about this, and I'll explain that to you after I have covered the next story. Again, the best practice and the next practice. If you have breast cancer, for example, you will have it invasive with mammography. Next practice will be non-invasive, no mammography. Best practice is still painful. Next practice is painless because you are doing non-invasive. Cost per scan, maybe US dollar 100 or maybe 50. Cost per scan, dollar one. Requires specialist. No specialist. Looks like a dream, isn't it? But that's precisely what young Mir Shah, who got the award year before last, got done. Eyebrace exam, low-cost tactile sensor that measures tissue stiffness difference in real time, non-invasively and without pain. Ultra-portable, accurate, minimal training, wireless and cloud-connected. Now you see this wonderful. You showed us the photograph, clap, following then the newspaper report and then everything is over. What happens to them afterwards? All right. Now this is where the difference comes, basically. The difference comes, like in the case of Mahesh, 3 weeks ago, exactly, what happened was this. GE Life Sciences, that is his company, his startup, and GE Healthcare announced a pivotal global partnership to make early detection of breast cancer accessible and affordable in 25 plus countries and for more than 500 million women. Can you just imagine? And Anil, I'm very proud to tell you, year before last, White Rose had asked me to give the opening plenary in Colombia, South America. And I still remember showing part of this, because this has happened recently, not this part, the earlier part. And David Tweed, who is the president of Danish Technology Institute, he actually came down to me and he said, we need it. Because in Denmark, you know, they have a lot of breast cancer incidents with old people and so on. Can you just imagine something that is invented in India, made in India, Danish want that because this is something called affordable excellence. Normally, whatever is affordable, you say it can't be excellent. Whatever is excellent can't be affordable. Now, here is a brilliant example of affordable excellence. That's number one. Number two, what I want you to notice is that all these three are startups. Right? And I told you earlier about Satyam, Shivam, Sundaram. What do they want to become? Bill Gates of this world. Billionaires. What do these people want to become? You know? So therefore, I always say, innovation, yes, up here. Passion in the belly, yes. But compassion in the heart. All three of them represent compassion in the heart. Innovation, compassion, and passion. So my idea of Startup India is that that Startup India will do something for my India, our India. All right? Or Bharat, if you like. I mean, those of you who are more keen to sort of see the nuances. But this is the story that in our own country, these young people, all of them 30 plus minus, are moving from best practice to next practice and for global good. What more proof do we require that we need? Let me come to the fourth point, incremental to disruptive. How did I define incremental to disruptive? Incremental is few percent, 10%, and disruptive is tenfold. So if you see the incremental innovation, incremental will be always evolutionary, gradual, where disruptive will be revolutionary. Within 1, 2, 5 years, you will see a major change. Incremental will be new to the company, but disruptive will be new to the world, basically. Incremental will be usually introduced by the incumbents, where disruptive will be by the new entrants. Because new entrants are the ones who do not know it cannot be done, basically. The next is just cost of feature improvement is what is done in incremental. You know, 1% better here, 2% better there, 5% better there, and so on. Not disruptive. Disruptive creates unprecedented performance features. Right? And the final one, incremental works on just existing products, services, markets, where disruptive creates completely new products, completely new services, and completely new markets. Now there are 10 what I like to call as exponential technologies that are causing disruption. What are they? First is Internet of Things. Second, artificial intelligence and machine learning. The third, robotics process automation. The fourth, virtual augmented mixed reality. Fifth, sensors, with their costs dropping dramatically. Sixth, 3D printing. Seventh, 3D visualization. Eighth, mobile internet and cloud. Nine, big data analytics, open data. And the 10th is going to be the blockchain. Now, why do I call it exponential? I will shortly explain. But the main point I want to make is that they are going beyond the realms of what you consider as possibilities. Take artificial intelligence, for example. Last year, history was created when AlphaGo beat the world champion, Lee Sedol. Go is the most complicated game, by the way. And it was predicted that a machine will beat after 10 years. It happened last year. But that is not so interesting, because that way Garry Kasparov was also beaten in 1997. That's not so interesting. What was interesting was that in game 2, the Mu-37, and since we talk about brain and the rest of it, in game 2, the Mu-37 that was made, the experts say that there is 1 in 10,000 chance that a human will make it. So machine learning, deep learning is going to an extent you cannot imagine. I can give 1 hour lecture on this, by the way. This is my favorite topic, the way these things are actually moving. So that's why these are so disruptive and they're so exponential, and they don't stand alone, by the way. It's always a combination of these that actually work. Moore's law, you are always aware of this, the number doubling up every 2 years. So annual improvement rate is 41.4%, basically. Just imagine you get interest rate if you keep something in the bank at 6%, right? You can see how your deposit increases. Here it is 41.4%, real exponential. And this growth has continued for 40 years almost. This is incredible. Similarly, there are other technology cost curves. Look at data storage. Just like there is Moore's law, there is a Crider's law. And the hard disk dollar per byte a bit is down 50% every 18 months. Similarly, there is digital imaging, Henry's law. The pixels per dollar, 59% per year. Network capacity, Butler's law of photonics, the dollar cost of transmitting a bit is decreased by 50% every 9 months. And same thing is happening with lithium ion batteries, dollar per unit, kilowatt hour is coming down 14% per year and so on and so forth. What it means is that these exponential technologies, and you can see that is happening faster and faster and faster and faster. Now when that happens, there are other disruptions that are coming up. And many of you who are doing science will be aware of this. Open source software, open data, and in Backend, by the way, I have given you the references like open knowledge, Udacity, Coursera, open source development, open innovation, open research, open business models, open APIs, open crowdfunding, and whole range of these things. So the digital disruption is incredible, basically, the way it is actually happening. And therefore, you are always combining different exponential technologies, like to, for example, when smartphone was created, it was data storage using Crider's law, digital imaging using Henry's law, network capacity using Butler's law, and touch screens and lithium-ion batteries, computing sensors, and so on and so forth. And you can see what difference they have made, okay? So technological innovation is, however, just one part. There are so many other innovations which become very important. And if you miss out on them, you lose. So first, you start with technology innovation. But then there is what is called a business model innovation. How did Jio offer voice call at zero, let us say, price, zero cost? It was a business model innovation. System delivery innovation. Workflow innovation, process innovation, organizational innovation, and policy innovation. And invariably, it is the combination of the three that actually, three or four of these, that sort of works together. Now, you would say, fine, technology is happening up there. Business model innovations, yes, we are aware. And actually, the paper that was referred to, the Harvard Business Review paper between me and C.K. Prahlad, that was his last paper, by the way, was all about not just technological business model innovation, but combining these innovations. Now, what are we doing in India as far as this is concerned? We are also doing the combinatorial end-to-end innovation to create disruption. Look at the great Indian innovation combinatorial, JAM. Jandhan Yojana as a policy. Then Aadhaar, which is both identification and authentication, again technology-based. A billion plus we have, and mobile, a billion plus. It was a combination of these three, technology plus policy, which actually led us to do something which created actually a world record, the fastest, largest financial inclusion in the world. It's a very clever combination of technological and non-technological innovation, including policy innovation, which has actually resulted in this, and that required a certain amount of imagination, I must say. Now, in the normal innovation that we talk about, the linear path, we say getting less performance from less resources. If you want to produce anything cheap, you cut down this, you cut down that, you cut down that, and somehow or other you produce a cheap product, right? So that it will be available for more and more people. That is the norm. Okay? The next thing is incremental innovation, but there is some innovation where you say you will get more performance from less resource, but for more people, basically. I would say this is more from less for more, MLM 1.0. MLM has become now sort of a favorite term, by the way. The disruptive innovation is, however, getting far more performance for far less resource for far more people. Okay? That is MLM 2.0. This term, by the way, more from less for more, you said I am very fond of creating this term. This was created in 2008 when I was elected to Australian Academy. You know, and I had to give a lecture in Canberra, basically, on innovation. And I said, what should I say? So, in order to make it attractive, I called it Gandhian engineering. So immediately you get surprised, you know, computer engineering, chemical, metallurgical, what is Gandhian engineering? So I picked up two things from Mahatma Gandhi. One was that there is enough for everyone's need, but not for everyone's greed. That means use your resources in such a way that your great grandchildren, their great children will have. So it is for more and more people, getting more from less for more and more people, basically. That's was the implication. And that became somehow or the other very popular to an extent that this is being used very widely, to an extent that last year in Munich, there was a full day symposium on more from less for more. And you might wonder why they are interested in more from less for more. It is obvious, basically, because you see the what is happening to the refugees, what is happening to the inequalities. In fact, if you ask me what are the two biggest worries for the world, one is climate change and second is inequality, which will cause this social disharmony. And in inequality, there is going to be a challenge because equality of income is going to take several years, but equality of access. So despite income inequality, if you can create access equality, like the examples I showed, when something is available for 5 rupees, you have it. That mother is able to make a video call for 1 rupee, you have it. That is access equality despite income inequality. That is the kind of innovation one is talking about. So that is that MLM 2.0. So, for example, India is expert in doing that, incremental to disruptive. You can see not 40% but 40 times cheaper high quality hepatitis B vaccine, recombinant DNA, high quality cataract eye surgery, Arvind eye care, 100 times cheaper, not 100%, by using a particular innovation which is what McDonald's does, by the way. It's a workflow innovation, all right? Assembly line approach, if you like. But the way they integrated it, basically, by subdividing the work also, so that the skilled part, the unskilled part is divided and the costs are brought down. This is incredible. High quality open heart surgery. You know, 20 times cheaper, not 20%, but the quality as good as the New York surgeon. Again, by workflow innovation. High quality artificial foot. 300 times cheaper, not 300%, Jaipur. In fact, I always show a film where somebody is wearing this Jaipur foot and he runs a kilometer in 4 minutes, 30 seconds. And then I go around the audience and asking them, how many of you can run a kilometer in 4 minutes, 30 seconds? And hardly a hand goes up, or a few from the young go up. So what I'm saying is, this is affordable excellence. Excellence, because he's able to run a kilometer in 4 minutes, 30 seconds. Affordable, because it is 100 times cheaper, all right? That is where India specializes, by the way, affordable excellence, okay? If you move forward then, this is the innovations holy grail paper that was being referred to by Balram Bhagava, and C.K. Prahlad wrote it, which actually looks at it from business point of view. There are three things that we talk about. The first thing is doing well. Doing well means what? Making a lot of money. Second is doing well and doing good. Like Bill Gates made a lot of money, and then he created a foundation. So doing well and doing good. But the third is doing well by doing good. So if those young people that you saw, they succeed by doing the business that they are going to do, what does it mean? They will be doing well by doing good, all right? Because they will be helping a lot of young people. So that's a paradigm shift, and how do you do that? That's what we covered. And those of you who are more interested in this, I have given a TED talk. There are more than 500,000 views. It is subtitled in 23 languages, which actually talks about the basic principles of doing this. Now, in order to do all this finally, again, it comes down to this. Two things. There is a mind and there is a mindset. Okay? No good having great mind. You have to have a great mindset. And when you don't have the great mindset, what happens is that if you are doing a brainstorming, for example, I'm taking an example, and you have people in the room, and there is a completely new idea, and you throw it. First response, too risky. The second, suppose it fails, fear of failure. Third, impossible, never done before. Hey, what do you mean by, iPhone was done before, iPhone came, no? But somehow there is this feeling. Fourth, somebody has tried it already. Now supposing you are afraid, you are scared, but you don't want to show it, but you have good English, you know what you will say? Let me play devil's advocate. But it means the same. So I suggest that in our science laboratories, in our business corporate boardrooms, you should put these five on the outside and say these phrases are banned. Alright? Anybody who uses it is out. Otherwise, you can't make those leaps that I basically talked about. And by the way, it is not just ordinary human being like us. Just see this. Steve Ballmer, CEO of Microsoft, 2007, and I knew him, by the way, because I was on the Microsoft External Research Advisory Board for 5 years. You remember what he said in 2007? That the first year I joined that External Research Advisory Board, there's no chance that the iPhone is going to get any significant market share. No chance. Everybody got his iPhone. The Bloomberg analyst had said, iPhone's impact will be minimal. It will only appeal to a few gadget freaks. Nokia and Motorola have nothing to worry about. Nokia went down, Motorola went down. Both of them. That was the advice, by the way, by the analyst. And Tom Watson, this is a famous statement, chairman of IBM, said, I think there is a world market for maybe 5 computers, basically. You can imagine, right? So how do you go over that? And for that, we require in India large number of innovation leaders. And I like to say that they require two qualities. The first is, innovation leader is one who does not know that it cannot be done. That's the first. The second is, innovation leader is one who sees what everyone else sees, but thinks of what no one else thinks. That is where you get Nobel Prizes, by the way. The same data, Nobel laureate looks at it and we look at it, right? And he sees something completely different. And there again, I can give 1 hour lecture in terms of, to do that, what kind of mind you require. You know, I mean, for example, we talk about serendipity, accidental breakthrough. I believe there is a lecture, or there is going to be a lecture on serendipity. I have, as a matter of fact, a lecture on science, innovation, and serendipity. And I don't call serendipity an accidental breakthrough. You know, eyes do not see what the mind does not know. And therefore, how do you prepare? Create a prepared mind, basically. That is where the breakthrough comes. Then you are able to see something, a business opportunity or a scientific breakthrough, which nobody else is able to see. Our educational system kills it right from the beginning. That's a separate 1 hour lecture, by the way. The innovation leaders are those who find opportunities where others see nothing, converts problem into an opportunity, set quantum goals, drive discontinuity based on risky ideas. Now you say you are giving a big lecture. What have you done in your life? You did science. You did leadership of science also. Have you taken any risk? I would say the answer is yes. This is not the time to talk about the science we did, but there's a paper in Current Science which I've written on chasing anomalies and discontinuities, the fun and joy of science, where I describe all the risks I took in my life and the new breakthroughs that we got. That's a separate subject altogether. But in terms of science leadership, we took a lot of risks. For example, right here in Pune, when I was director of National Chemical Laboratory, we created what is called the Kite Flying Fund. 1% of the fund, but given to ideas which were out of this world. All right, where chance of success would be 1 in 100. And that created a magic because people had license to fail, so as to say. It was a new feeling. It was so fiercely competitive, Kamosab, right? And you will remember, we worked together in CSR. When I came there, I created this new idea fund. You remember, basically? And lots of great ideas came from that. In fact, I remember Chandramohan creating 2 US patents on spin computers at that time, US patents. But we did not have the ecosystem to take that forward, basically. So we're not short of ideas, by the way. You know, that's what it shows. Then in the public-private partnership, we created a New Millennium Indian Technology Leadership Initiative, CSIR, basically. Biggest public-private partnership that India has actually seen. But private sector is also doing that, by the way, taking risks. For example, Tata's. They have something called Dare to Try. It's a very interesting story. Ratan Tata had invited me to speak in Goa when they had an offsite, you know, and all their leadership was there. And the title of my talk was Innovation is a Way of Life. The year was 2006. And I mentioned a story there that a CEO, a friend of mine, had come from US and he was talking to me and he said, "We don't hang people who make mistakes, but we do hang people who don't take risks. What do you do in India?" I said, "We hang people who take risks." Everybody laughed. There was one person who did not laugh, Ratan. He said, "What do we do, you know, so that people will take risks?" I said, "Celebrate those who dare to try." And that became daring to try. That's the most favorite, by the way, competitions that they have in Tata's. And how it has percolated in the culture, it is incredible. About 4 or 5 years ago, I was the chief guest for giving the innovation awards and there were 3 stalls. Okay? One was, "Yes, we did it. Some great achievement." The second was, "We are at it. Hoary goals, but we are at it." The third one was, "We tried, but." Can you just imagine in a corporation the failures being displayed with pride, basically? So that is happening. I told you about Beyond Us in Reliance. There is a program called Dare to Dream. I hope they have changed the name because they had called it Failed Innovation. And recently I was invited to speak Mahindra Research Valley. So I saw their failed innovation. I didn't like it, so I mailed to Anand Mahindra. And I said, "Look, I look at fail as a different. Fail is first attempt in learning." I repeat, fail is F-A-I-L, first attempt in learning. So give it a positive spin. And he liked this. I gave some alternative, Dare to Dream. So I hope they have changed it by now. I'm not so sure. But I'll give you both these versions. But basically what I'm saying is that there is this particular movement. Let's take this. Let's run. Let's bet on the young. Let's have great ideas. The last part of my talk, first to India to first to the world. That is where our big challenge has been. Professor Jayan Narlikar, I don't know whether he's in audience or not, but he has written a book and there he talks about the 10 top achievements of 20th century. He starts with Ramanujan, mathematics in 20s, then goes to Meghnasar, ionization equation, then Essenbos, particle statistics, as we know what difference it has made, Bose-Einstein equation, and boson, and I mean whole C.V. Raman, Raman effect, the only Nobel Prize for doing work in India, and G.N. Ramachandran, molecular biophysics. He should have got a Nobel Prize, triple helix, and the rest of it, okay? And what happens? And I have kept a big gap there. These are the first 50 years. After that, he lists Atomic Energy Commission, nuclear power, very proud, Anil, Green Revolution, 70s, space program, late 70s, superconductivity, some excellent breakthrough work came. And last release, I'm happy to see the CSR transformation that we did in late 90s. But none of them actually are scientific breakthroughs that we have. None of them are science-led enterprises creating the Apples of this world, or the Microsofts of this world, or the Intels of this world. All right? This has to change. And that cannot change unless we say, we are happy saying the first word in science. We are happy in generics. Yeah, they are cheap. I agree. They are needed. I agree. But with that, how do you, not just copying molecules, but creating molecules? All right? How do we do that? I think that is time that we move on that. The myth is that Indian genes express in Silicon Valley and not in Indus Valley. Right? The reality is that given challenge, they can express in Indus Valley. I'll prove it to you. For example, in 1995, 4th March, I remember giving the Lala Karamchand Thapar Memorial Lecture, and then Finance Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh had presided over this. And the lecture was India's emergence as a global R&D platform, the new challenges and opportunities. Because what I was saying was something very simple. I said, how the future competition is going to go? The future competition is going to go this way. Product is not going to be the competitive factor. Product draws value from the market for you. But how do you create that product? By assembling skills, fast, smart, at the highest level and deliver. So I said it's not going to be product-based competition, skill-based competition. And if it is skill, it is talent, then India has to win. And I said everybody will be in search of India and R&D centers will be located here. Nobody believed me at that time. This is as usual, this dangerous optimist is talking about it. I'm sorry, today there are 1,126 R&D centers employing 350,000 plus scientists, basically, of all the top companies of the world, the biggest being Cisco, 20,000, by the way, and any number of them are 5,000, 10,000, and so on and so forth. And on that, I have written an article just last year on what is the scenario, why it is building up, and so on. But the most important part is this. Look at the patterns that they generate. You will see 2003 to 2013, for which I have the data. Novel was generating just 4% in India of the US patents. They are generating 28% now. Symantec had nothing, they are 24%. G Bangalore R&D Center share of overall US granted patents has increased from 1% to 12%. So what is happening? There is Indian IQ, which is not in Silicon Valley. It is in Indus Valley. But they are not in our laboratories. They are in the multinational laboratories. And they are creating world-class IP. That means they are capable of doing that. All right. Now, for me, for all of us, the question is, Indian IQ, can it pole vault India by solving Indian problems? Using the same brain, the same IQ. Okay? The answer is yes. And I'll give an example. For example, leapfrogging to pole vaulting. Could we make 200 million literates, illiterates, literate in 5 years? Yes. We have breakthrough technology created by Indian IQ, Indian talent, computer-based functional literacy. This was created by in TCS under Mr. Kohli's leadership. What does it do? This special Indian sort of mind, they created that. They say based on the theories of cognition, language, communication, emphasizing on learning words rather than alphabets. All right. So word is recognized as a picture, like mother. Vijayalakshmi, mother. When you learned A, B, C, D, I learned. First A, B, C, D, and then we'll start mugging up M-O-T-H-A-R mother, M-O-T-H-A-R mother, etc. No, you recognize mother as a picture. Okay? And method focuses on reading. And with that, what they have done is 4 times faster, the duration. You don't take 200 hours, 45 hours for reading a newspaper. You don't require professional teachers, para teachers will do. Dropout rates are high here. In the conventional, they are low there. Spoken and visual medium, not possible. This is possible here. Disruption is learning alphabets, recognizing just 596 pictures. cost is very high there. Here it is fractional, just $2 per person. $2 per person, can you just imagine? For 100 rupees per person, you can make entire India literate. All right, 200, 250 million, we don't have the exact numbers. You know, and time for 90% would reduce from 20 years to 5 years. Okay, we have 5-year plans, isn't it? Why don't we have a 5-year plan on making entire India literate by using that IQ, the kind of talent that we are taking? It requires technology plus policy, right? And then we can have it. The challenge, other challenge is Indian IQ pole vaulting India's position in global competitiveness. Is it possible? It was possible. For example, look at Simputer. You know, it is amazing. This Bruce Sterling, New York Times Magazine, wrote in 2001, the most significant innovation in computer technology in 2001 was not Apple's gleaming titanium PowerBook G4 or Microsoft Windows XP. It was the Simputer, a net-linked, radically simple, portable computer intended to bring the computer revolution to the third world. Can you just imagine? And it was ahead in terms of technology. Accelerometer, which was to be used in iPhone later, was used by them. Some of the technologies which have gone in Samsung's Galaxy were actually used by them. What was required? There is the big challenge. What was missing was a bold, innovative public procurement policy for innovation and of innovation. And I'll explain that to you. Challenge on liquid crystal display with two orders of faster switching times. Can you just imagine, Anil, the Liquid Crystal Research Center in Bangalore did achieve this. Not only that, it was so good they got a US patent. But then what? We did not have the ecosystem to take it forward. Because this is New Millennium Indian Technology Leadership Initiative. They were leaders. But it did not convert into technology, business leadership. Because technology to business requires so many other things. Similarly, I had said, simplifying it, a laptop, $2,000, can you do it in $200, basically? Yes, Vinay Deshpande actually delivered it on 10 May 2005. Now, you can just imagine if there was a public procurement where, say, order for 10,000 or 100,000 was placed. It would have made such a difference. Because then the idea is government become the first buyer. Okay, in other countries, the government become the first buyer. And then we move forward. The risk taking, because the proven, the customer experience, everything comes after that. Of course, it has got converted into a DSK Mobilis, high net worth individual sort of purchased it, and it is being sold, by the way. It's not a failure, but it's not sold in millions. And I'm very happy that in the Startup India incentives that the government is going, they are looking at this public procurement support. This is the first time I have actually seen that, and that's really wonderful. Because it is like this, you know, very frankly. Sachin Tendulkar, when he was 15 years, 7 months and 7 days old, he hit a century, first in his first Ranji Trophy. To lay a bet on him is something different than when he was playing with his mother, when he was 4 or 5. And then laying a bait on you. There's a difference between the two. Okay? How do we start laying those baits early enough on our young, I think, is the challenge. And therefore, there was a particular discussion in Niti Aayog basically on this very issue. And I have written a paper called Innovative Public Procurement Policy for Fueling Assured Inclusive Innovation, where a lot of radical changes have been suggested. And Niti Aayog is bringing out a book, The Path Ahead, Anthology of Transformative Ideas for India. And this came up, Anil, in a very interesting way. They had invited me to chair a brainstorming session about India at 75. And one of the individuals said, what is the use of Mashelkar committees? Because, you know, Swachh Bharat, I chair the technology expert committee. We recommend the best. He said, finally, when it comes to the crux, we have to go for L1. We can't get the best. You know, that is where the churning took place. How do we go for the best, basically, and not get restricted by our conviction? I hope something will happen. I'm very happy that these initiatives are being taken. Assured, let me explain to you.
And I think this is something you might want to note, because when Balram Bhargava was speaking about industry and so on and so forth, I think what we have to see as far as India is concerned, it has to be affordable, if possible, extremely affordable. It has to be scalable, because we are talking about 1.25 billion. It has to be sustainable in three terms. First, environmental, ecological. Secondly, economically sustainable, because you can't just rely on the crutches of the government subsidies. And last is socially sustainable, basically, acceptable, because otherwise it will not be sustainable. It has to be universal, user-friendly, basically. All right? All the three innovations that I showed to you earlier of Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Awards, they are so user-friendly. People can actually use them because they are non-invasive. Rapid speed is the essence. Excellence I talked about, and you can see the contradiction. Affordability and excellence comes together, and it has to be distinctive, hopefully disruptive. Okay, not me too. These are the criteria. Now you can start using these criteria for anything that you have, including for institutions, by the way. I have tried that, including for now multinational drug companies. Start using this. Are they affordable? No. Scalable? No, because their drugs are so expensive, they are used by a few people. Sustainable? No. Universal? No. Rapid? No, because their processes are so sort of slow. I mean, of course, in biomedical research, you will always have them. Excellence? Yes. High quality science. Distinctive? Yes, but sometimes they copy by extending the patent. As against, you look at the other innovation that we talked about. Geo, for example. Is it affordable? Yes. Zero price. Zero is excellent. Scalable, yes, because we are talking about 150 million customers. Sustainable, yes. The first quarter itself was EBIT positive. Universal, yes. Everybody can use it. Rapid, yes. Fastest, 83 days. Excellent, yes. Highest technology is used. Distinctive, yes, in terms of technology as a business model. So I think for businesses, this can apply. For your innovations, it can apply. For institutions, it can apply. It can apply for India. Basically, all right? So these are the criteria, and I wrote these down because how do you select? Finally, when you are taking risk, you know, in funding something that is entirely new, how do you? And these will have to be actually sort of spelled out. The final point is, I talked about lots of things where scientists, technologists, and everybody will get involved and so on and so forth. But I must say emphatically that we require democratization of innovation, because I have a fundamental belief that everyone is someone. Everybody can generate an idea. 1.25 billion Indians are not 1.2 billion miles, but 1.25 billion minds. And minds on the margin are not marginal minds, as my friend Anil Gupta always says, basically. Everybody is capable of that. And that is where our National Innovation Foundation, who does this grassroots innovation work, which is led by Professor Anil Gupta, you know, I call him modern Gandhi, doing Shodha Yatras, 15, 20 kilometers, you know, villages, and so on and so forth. So we are discovering that. And I'm very happy to say that this has found a pride of place now in Rashtrapati Bhavan. This was about 6 months ago that the erstwhile president actually inaugurated in the center, you know, a special hall on people's innovation for people. You know, I mean, it was fantastic. And what is most remarkable is on 24 July, which was the last official event that the outgoing president had, his last act, can you believe, it was connected with innovation. And here is that, and I'll end with that. You can see here the book being released in terms of people's innovation. You see the prime minister there, the incoming president, the then president, vice president, Professor Anil Gupta, who masterminded this particular book. And I would cherish this as an everlasting memory in my life, because this is the greatest endorsement that you can have for innovation, and that you can have for the fact that everyone is someone and everybody can create a new India. So a world-class innovation ecosystem, finally, we have to build. It will require physical constructs, intellectual construct, but cultural construct. Innovation as a culture, basically, right from childhood to the mother, to the father, to the teacher, to every member of society. We require critical innovation support systems, education, research institutions like the great ones in which you work, We require incubators, we require accelerators, we require technology parks, and as I said, we require adventure capital, not just adventure. The government society institution have to, like public procurement policies that I talked about, robust IPR regime, balanced regulatory systems. There's no use discovering new molecules if people have to finally go to US and Canada to do research. And you know what I'm talking about, basically. So we require those systems and strategically designed standards. Anil, I find that we are still not using standards in terms of strategy. Then we can have innovation-led accelerated growth, and then India has a leading innovation economy. And my dream is always discover in India, innovate in India, and make in India. Make in India does not mean assembled in India. Let me take just 1 minute to explain that and I will close. This is my last slide. See, Foxconn makes iPhones. Many of you are carrying them. Okay? In China, 4.5 million jobs are created. How much does Foxconn take? $10 per iPhone. That's their profit. How much does Apple take? $350. Okay? So, Kamalji, there are three options India has. One is sweat it out, create 4.5 million jobs, we require them, but get $10. Other one is thoda socho, right? And get $350. But not many jobs because only techies. But the third is take that $10, take that $350, make in India, invent in India, basically. Not just assembled in India. That's the new India that we want. And therefore, in that J.R.D. Tata lecture, I ended by saying, it is only this innovative India that will signal to the rest of the world that we are not a hesitant nation, unsure of our place in the new global order, but a confident one that is raring to go and be a leader in the Committee of Nations. Thank you very much.
Friends, I'm sure all of you have a feeling of just coming out of a concert. And I'm not saying that because this is evening, but I'm saying because that's how I felt it. I quoted a few Mashelkar sayings earlier. I want to continue that practice. And I think somewhere he had said, and I think he said many times, and it was also, it came out in this talk, and that's, India is a land of ideas, no dearth of ideas. And the question is, can we make India the land of opportunities? The way many countries in the West are, or the reason why Indians in Silicon Valley bloom. As academy, of course, we can say this is innovation is, or innovation ecosystem is something way beyond research, way beyond science and technology. It is. But then if whatever we do, it has to contribute to national development, as we are discussing in this meeting, then again, I think we have to shed, even this to me is a silo mentality. If we do something, and if that has some potential for the national good, I think we must go that distance and take it to the people for their benefit. And I think as it's not that everything academic can do, but as thought leaders, there are many things that all of us, as the fellows and members of NASI, can do. And I think the message to me from this wonderful lecture is to think about this and make a few resolves to realize whatever is embedded in the theme of this symposium, which of course we'll continue to discuss tomorrow. So, Dr. Mashelkar, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. has been just wonderful.
Thank you very much, sir, for your very nice, wonderful and exciting lecture on innovation from leaf fogging to pole vaulting. So there is a very small felicitation program. So I will request Professor Kakodkar to felicitate Professor Mashelkar by offering shawl, bouquet and memento.
So, we have a word of felicitation for Dr. Mashelkar sir. Oh dear Mashelkar sir, you are dreamy, dangerous and daring, beyond the reach of clouds and computing, marvelous in thoughts, innovative in action. Oh Mashelkar sir, you are the pride of nation. Thank you.